Hello, welcome once again to the Hurricane Utah Adult Religion class, sponsored by the Hurricane Utah North Stake of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. My name is Mike Parker, the instructor for the class. The Hurricane Adult Religion class meets on Thursday evenings between September and May to discuss the scriptures of the restored Church of Jesus Christ. If you live in or are visiting the Hurricane St. George area, I'd love to have you join us. Dates, times, and location are available on the class website. Links to the class website are available in the show notes for this video. On the website, you can download my notes, which includes footnotes documenting my sources, this PowerPoint slide presentation, and handouts that I distribute in class. Please note that this YouTube channel and the class website are not official sites of The Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, the Hurricane Utah North Stake, or any other church unit or department. I alone am responsible for these sites and the materials on them. If you enjoyed this lesson, please click the like button and share it with a friend. And subscribe if you want to be notified when new content is posted to this channel. It really does help. In this lesson, we'll be studying the account of the decline of Nephite society and the ministry of the brothers Nephi and Lehi in Helaman chapters 1 through 12. There are many named individuals in this lesson. Some of them only make a brief appearance, so I'll mention them as we go along. There are a few I'd like to introduce up front, though. Helaman III was the oldest son of Helaman II and a grandson of Alma II. He kept the record on the large plates of Nephi, and the book of Helaman is named for him. Nephi II and Lehi IV were the sons of Helaman III. Kishkumen and Gadianton were the founders of a secret society that was created to murder and to get gain. The events in this lesson can be divided into five sections. The Nephites' wickedness led to turmoil, murder, and internal and external wars, chapters 1 through 4. The preaching ministry of Nephi and Lehi, chapter 5. The Lamanites became more righteous than the Nephites, the rise of the Gadianton robbers, chapter 6. The ministry and prophecies of Nephi, chapters 7 through 11. And Mormon's commentary on the unsteadiness of the hearts of the children of men, chapter 12. The events recorded in these chapters took place throughout all known Book of Mormon lands, including the Nephite and Lamanite homelands in the south, collectively called the Land of Lehi, and the land northward, called Mulek. In the land northward, the Nephites discovered large bodies of water and many rivers. The narrative in this lesson covers a span of 46 years, from the commencement of the 40th year of the reign of the judges, circa 55 BC, to the end of the 85th year, circa 11 BC. Recapping from previous lessons, in the 31st year of the reign of the judges, the Nephites achieved victory over the Lamanites after a devastating seven-year war. Over the next 8 years, many of the military and religious leaders of that generation died, including Helaman II, Moroni, and Shiblon, and many Nephites migrated to the land northward, away from the land of Zarahemla. At the commencement of the 40th year, the chief judge's office was held by Pahoran, who had fought alongside Moroni in the Great Lamanite War. As he did for most of the books he wrote, Mormon composed a heading for the Book of Helaman that summarizes its narrative content. This heading was translated by the prophet Joseph Smith from the Plates of Mormon and is therefore part of the scriptural text of the Book of Mormon. At the commencement of the Book of Helaman, Pahoran, the chief judge, died, and three of his sons sought to fill the judgment seat. Pahoran II was chosen by the voice of the people. His brother, Paonkai, incited a rebellion, but was arrested, tried, and executed for sedition. Kishkumen, a supporter of Paeonkai, murdered Pahoran II on the judgment seat and evaded capture. Kishkumen and his group formed a secret society with the goal of overthrowing the Nephite government. Pecumeni, Pahoran's other brother, became the chief judge. 10 years after the end of the Great Lamanite War, the Lamanite king Tubaloth appointed Coriantumr III, a Nephite dissenter who was a descendant of Mulek, as leader of the Lamanite armies, and ordered him to attack the Nephites in the land of Zarahemla. The Nephites were so divided among themselves that their defenses were weak. Coriantumr took the city of Zarahemla with ease and killed Pecumeni, the chief judge. Overconfident because of his easy victory, Coriantumr marched through the center of the land toward the city of Bountiful, slaying the people with a great slaughter and taking possession of many cities and many strongholds. He intended to take the land northward and surround the Nephites. Moronihah and Lehi stopped the Lamanites' advance, killed Coriantumr, and surrounded and defeated the Lamanite army. Zarahemla was liberated, and the Nephites allowed the captive Lamanites to return to their homeland. With Pecumeni now dead, Helaman III, grandson of Alma and keeper of the Nephites' sacred records, was appointed as the next chief judge. A man named Gadianton, who was exceedingly expert in many words and also in his craft to carry on the secret work of murder and of robbery, became the leader of the band of Kishkumen. He promised to appoint Kishkumen's followers to positions of power if they made him chief judge. It was their secret plan and their combination to murder and to rob and to gain power. Secret combinations have been mentioned previously in the Book of Mormon. They had been the cause of the downfall of the Jaredites. It was through the efforts of Kishkumen and Gadianton that they were introduced into Nephite society. We no longer use the term combination the way it was used in Joseph Smith's time. Noah Webster's 1828 American Dictionary of the English Language defined it as an intimate union or association of two or more persons or things by set purpose or agreement for effecting some object by joint operation. In a good sense, when the object is laudable. In an ill sense, when it is illegal or iniquitous. It is sometimes equivalent to a league or to conspiracy. We say a combination of men to overthrow government or a combination to resist oppression. The Oxford English Dictionary adds to this the meanings of a conspiracy, self-interested or illegal confederacy, and an association or society formed for that purpose. The Book of Mormon indicates that the purpose of secret combinations is to get gain, to be praised of men, yea, and that they might get gold and silver, for the which they do murder and plunder and steal and bear false witness against their neighbor and do all manner of iniquity. To advance these objectives, those involved in combinations make mutual covenants of secrecy. The secret combinations in the Book of Mormon included oaths that whoso should divulge whatsoever thing was made known unto them, the same should lose his life. Elder M. Russell Ballard taught, quote, "The Book of Mormon teaches that secret combinations engaged in crime present a serious challenge, not just to individuals and families, but to entire civilizations. Among today's secret combinations are gangs, drug cartels, and organized crime families. Among their purposes are to murder and plunder and steal and commit whoredoms and all manner of wickedness contrary to the laws of their country and also the laws of their God. If we are not careful, today's secret combinations can obtain power and influence just as quickly and just as completely as they did in Book of Mormon times. Do you remember the pattern? The secret combinations began among the more wicked part of society, but eventually seduced the more part of the righteous until the whole society was polluted. Unquote. Hugh Nibley once said, quote, "From the international drug and arms traffic to the sneaky chemical additions in the supermarket, the principle applies, life in exchange for profits." One example should suffice. This month, a headline announces that radiation dump could bring cash to Tooele County. Some counties actually clamor to convert the land bountiful into the land desolation for a quick buck. Unquote. Anytime we conspire with others to lie or cheat so that we might increase our own material standing, profit, or power at the expense of others, we are engaged in a secret combination. Secret combinations are Satan's false counterfeit of sacred covenants, which the Lord's people make in holy temples. In the temple, we covenant to lead lives of holiness and righteousness to advance the kingdom of God. We keep these covenants sacred, which means that we do not discuss the details of them openly in the world. Secret combinations are covenants to lead lives of wickedness for material gain. Those who enter into them keep them secret, not out of respect for the covenant, but because of fear of retaliation. Kishkumen attempted to murder Helaman on the judgment seat, but one of Helaman's servants learned of the secret combination, intercepted Kishkumen, and killed him with a knife before he could carry out his intentions. Gadianton and his band of robbers fled into the wilderness to avoid capture. Mormon ominously informed his readers, "Ye shall see that this Gadianton did prove the overthrow, yea, almost the entire destruction of the people of Nephi." After 3 years of relative peace, there was much contention and many dissensions among the Nephites. Because of this, an exceedingly great many Nephites left the land of Zarahemla for the land northward, called Mulek, or Desolation. They traveled to where there were large bodies of water and many rivers. Because there had been great deforestation in the northern lands, the Nephites lived in houses made of cement, in tents, and in structures made from wood shipped from the south. The Nephites now covered the face of the whole earth, from the sea south to the sea north, from the sea west to the sea east. Mormon paused here to remind us that what we're reading is an abridgment of the source material he had in his possession. "There were many records kept of the proceedings of this people," he wrote. "Because of the great number of records, a hundredth part of the proceedings of this people cannot be contained in this work," that is to say, the Book of Mormon. Mormon also informed us that the Nephites in his own time had fallen into transgression and had been destroyed as a people due to the same transgressions as the Nephites in Helaman's time. Helaman carried out his duties as chief judge with justice and equity, doing that which was right in the sight of God continually. He had two sons, Nephi the second and Lehi the fourth, who began to grow up unto the Lord. When Helaman died, Nephi became chief judge in his father's stead. In the 49th and 50th years of the judges, the Nephites were righteous. The Lord blessed and prospered them, so much so that even the high priests and the teachers were themselves astonished beyond measure. Tens of thousands of people were baptized. The following year, pride began to enter into the hearts of the people who professed to belong to the Church of God. These people began to persecute those who kept themselves humble, pure, and sanctified, which sanctification cometh because of their yielding their hearts unto God. In the 54th year, there were many dissensions in the church, insomuch that there was much bloodshed. Over the next 3 years, rebellious Nephites were driven out of Nephite lands. They went to the Lamanites and endeavored to convince them to attack the Nephites. Despite their initial hesitancy, in the 57th year, the Lamanites again invaded the land of Zarahemla. By the following year, the Lamanite forces had conquered and occupied the entire southern portion of the land of Zarahemla, right up to the land Bountiful in the north. Moronihah's army fortified a defensive line to protect Bountiful and the north country. In the 60th and 61st years of the Judges, Moronihah and his armies succeeded in regaining even the half of all their possessions that they had lost to the Lamanites. Mormon explained the spiritual reasons behind the Nephites' great losses. Helaman chapter 4, verses 11 through 13, quote, "Now this great loss of the Nephites, and their great slaughter which was among them, would not have happened had it not been for their wickedness and their abomination which was among them, yea, and it was among those also who professed to belong to the church of God. And it was because of the pride of their hearts, because of their exceeding riches, yea, it was because of their oppression to the poor, withholding their food from the hungry, withholding their clothing from the naked, and smiting their humble brethren upon the cheek, making a mock of that which was sacred, denying the spirit of prophecy and of revelation, murdering, plundering, lying, stealing, committing adultery, rising up in great contentions, and dissenting away into the land of Nephi among the Lamanites. And because of their great wickedness and their boastings in their own strength, they were left in their own strength. Therefore they did not prosper, but they were afflicted and smitten and driven before the Lamanites until they had lost possession of almost all their lands." Unquote. Moronihah, Nephi, and Lehi had preached, prophesied, and warned the Nephites about what would happen if they did not repent. The Nephites had repented, and inasmuch as they did repent, they did begin to prosper. They had reclaimed half of their lands because of their humility. Moronihah was unable to reclaim any more Nephite lands in the following year, so he and his armies set about to fortify what they had retaken so they could retain it. The Nephite people remembered the warnings of Alma and Mosiah against becoming prideful, stiff-necked, and disobedient. They saw that they had become corrupt, wicked, disbelieving, and weak, and that the Lord could no longer preserve and protect them against the Lamanites because of their transgressions, and the judgments of God did stare them in the face. What we see happening to the Nephites in this portion of the Book of Mormon is called the Prosper Bondage Cycle. This cycle is one of the most poignant themes in the Book of Mormon. It begins with righteousness and prosperity. Prosperity leads to pride and wickedness. Wickedness is followed by destruction and repentance. Repentance leads to righteousness and prosperity, and the cycle begins all over again. This cycle appears repeatedly in the Book of Mormon and is one of the book's primary messages. Societies rise and fall based on their obedience or disobedience to the commandments of God. This principle is at the heart of the covenant the Lord made with Lehi. "Inasmuch as ye shall keep my commandments, ye shall prosper in the land. But inasmuch as ye will not keep my commandments, ye shall be cut off from my presence." Many of the Book of Mormon's authors, including and especially Mormon, witnessed this cycle and warned us, the book's future readers, to not fall into the same trap that their people did. Elder Joseph B. Worthlin of the Twelve taught, quote, "When the people are righteous, the Lord prospers them. Prosperity often leads to pride, which leads to sin. Sin leads to wickedness and to hearts that become hardened to things of the Spirit. Eventually, the end of this road leads to heartbreak and sorrow. This pattern is repeated not only in the lives of individual people, but by cities, nations, and even the world. The consequences of ignoring the Lord and his prophets are certain and often accompanied by great sorrow and regret. In our day, the Lord has warned that wickedness will ultimately lead to famine and plague and earthquake and the thunder of heaven until the inhabitants of the earth be made to feel the wrath and indignation and chastening hand of an almighty God." Unquote. Because the Nephites were ripening for destruction due to their corruption and stiff-neckedness, Nephi resigned as chief judge to preach the word of God all the remainder of his days with his brother Lehi. Their father Helaman had been dead for 9 years, but they recalled the counsel he had given them. He had given them the names Nephi and Lehi so they would remember their forefathers who left Jerusalem and their good works, so that they would also do that which is good. Helaman had exhorted them to treasure up the gift of eternal life and to remember the teachings of Mosiah and Amulek about salvation and redemption in Christ through repentance. Helaman had concluded with this powerful petition in chapter 5, verse 12, quote, "And now, my sons, remember, remember that it is upon the rock of our Redeemer, who is Christ, the Son of God, that ye must build your foundation, that when the devil shall send forth his mighty winds, yea, his shafts in the whirlwind, yea, when all his hail and his mighty storm shall beat upon you, it shall have no power over you to drag you down to the gulf of misery and endless woe, because of the rock upon which ye are built, which is a sure foundation, a foundation whereon, if men build, they cannot fall." Unquote. Nephi and Lehi went and preached with great power to Nephites and Lamanites who lived in the land of Zarahemla. Many of the Nephite dissenters who had gone over to the Lamanites repented, were baptized, and returned to repair the wrongs they had done to the Nephites. 8,000 Lamanites in the land of Zarahemla were convinced of the wickedness of the traditions of their fathers and were baptized. Nephi and Lehi went to preach among the Lamanites in the land of Nephi, where they were captured and thrown into prison. After suffering many days without food, their captors, a mixed group of Lamanites and Nephite dissenters, came to kill them, but Nephi and Lehi were surrounded and protected by a pillar of fire. The two prophets testified to their jailers that it was God who had done this marvelous thing. There was a great earthquake, followed by a cloud of darkness, and a voice from heaven commanding their captors, repent ye, and seek no more to destroy my servants, whom I have sent unto you to declare good tidings. The voice was a still voice of perfect mildness, as if it had been a whisper, and it did pierce even to the very soul, and it was accompanied by another earthquake. The voice spoke two more times. The last time it said, marvelous words which cannot be uttered by man. The walls trembled again. Their captors were unable to flee because of the cloud of darkness and the fear that had overwhelmed them. Aminadab, a Nephite dissenter, saw Nephi and Lehi transfigured and conversing with angels. He told the Lamanites to repent and have faith in Christ. When the Lamanites did so, the cloud of darkness dispersed, and every one of them was encircled by a pillar of fire. They were filled with joy and the Holy Spirit, and could speak forth marvelous words. The voice whispered to them, peace, peace be unto you, because of your faith in my well-beloved, who was from the foundation of the world. The heavens opened, and angels came down and ministered to them. 300 people who witnessed this miraculous event went forth among their Lamanite brothers and sisters, witnessing what they had seen and heard. More than half of the Lamanites were convinced by their testimonies, laid down their weapons, and returned the rest of the lands they had taken from the Nephites 4 years earlier. By the end of that year, the righteousness of the Lamanites exceeded that of the Nephites, for the Nephites had become hardened and impenitent and grossly wicked, insomuch that they did reject the word of God and all the preaching and prophesying which did come among them. Helaman chapter 6, verse 3, quote, "Nevertheless, the people of the church did have great joy because of the conversion of the Lamanites, yea, because of the church of God, which had been established among them. And they did fellowship one with another, and did rejoice one with another, and did have great joy." Unquote. The gospel of Jesus Christ rejects racial prejudice and cultural animosity. The example set by the Nephite and Lamanite believers demonstrates how we should worship together in unity, regardless of any differences we may have. Many Lamanite missionaries preached among the Nephites in the land of Zarahemla and in the land northward. Nephites and Lamanites both enjoyed peace, free travel, and free commerce, and both prospered, flourished, and multiplied. In the 66th year of the reign of the judges, Cezoram, the chief judge in the city of Zarahemla, was murdered by an unknown person, and his son and successor was also murdered. The Gadianton robbers, the secret organization formed by Kishkumen and Gadianton, which consisted of wicked Nephites and Lamanites, was responsible for the murders. Many wicked Nephites did enter into the Gadianton's covenants and their oaths. They had secret signs and words by which they could identify others within their group, and anyone who revealed these secrets would be tried by the laws of the Gadiantons. These things had been revealed to Gadianton by Satan, who brought them forth from the beginning of man even down to this time. The Lamanites were able to eliminate the Gadiantons from their society, but the wicked Nephites did build them up and support them, even until they did obtain the sole management of the Nephite government. The Spirit of the Lord withdrew from the Nephites, and they were in an awful state and ripening for an everlasting destruction. Chapters 7 through 11 describe the ministry and prophecies of Nephi. Note that the headnote before chapter 7 was written by Mormon and is part of the scriptural text of the Book of Mormon. After preaching unsuccessfully in the land northward for over 5 years, Nephi returned to the city of Zarahemla to find the Nephites in a state of such awful wickedness and those Gadianton robbers filling the judgment seats. Corruption, theft, and murder were rampant. Nephi climbed the tower in his garden that overlooked the main road leading to the city's marketplace. He did exclaim in the agony of his soul that he wished he could have lived in the days of his ancestor Nephi when the people had been righteous. A large crowd gathered along the roadside. They wanted to know why Nephi was in such great mourning. Nephi preached to them, condemning them for their wickedness and pleading with them to repent. He warned them, "If ye will not repent, behold, this great city of Zarahemla, and also those great cities which are round about, which are in the land of our possession, shall be taken away, that ye shall have no place in them." He told them that the Lord would be more merciful to the Lamanites than to the Nephites, because the Nephites had united themselves with the Gadianton band and were proud and wicked. "I know that these things are true," he testified, "because the Lord God has made them known unto me." There were judges in the crowd who belonged to the Gadianton band. They tried to incite the people to seize Nephi and bring him to judgment for reviling and condemning all of Nephite society. Many people in the crowd, however, agreed with Nephi and accepted him as a prophet, so the Gadiantons were put to silence. Nephi continued to preach. He declared that he had the same power that God had given to Moses. Therefore, if the people denied his words, then they also denied the teachings of Moses and all prophets before and after Abraham concerning the Son of God. He again condemned them and warned that they would be destroyed unless they repented. As evidence that destruction was nearly upon the Nephites, Nephi announced by revelation that Cezoram, the chief judge in Zarahemla, had been murdered by his own brother, and that both men were members of the Gadianton band. 5 men in the crowd, none of whom accepted Nephi as a prophet, ran to the city and found Cezoram lying in a pool of his own blood. They believed Nephi's words, and fear came upon them lest all the judgments which Nephi had spoken should come upon the people. They fell to the earth as if they were dead. Bystanders found the chief judge's body and believed the 5 fallen men were the murderers and that God had smitten them, so they had the men imprisoned. Cezoram was buried the next day. The other judges who were in the crowd and who had heard Nephi's prophecy inquired about the 5 men. The men were brought from prison, and they told the judges all they had seen. The judges accused Nephi of being part of a conspiracy to kill the chief judge and to set himself up as a prophet. Nephi was arrested and questioned about Cizorim's murder. The judges offered him money and promised to spare his life if he confessed to being part of a plot to kill the chief judge. Nephi rebuked them for their great sins and again prophesied their destruction. He then revealed, by the power of God, that Seantum, Cizorim's brother, was the murderer. He set forth in detail what would happen when they questioned Seantum. They would find Cizorim's blood on the bottom of his brother's cloak, and Seantum would confess to the crime. Seantum was questioned, and everything came to pass as Nephi foretold. Some Nephites accepted him as a prophet, while others believed he was a god. As Nephi was returning to his home, the voice of the Lord spoke to him. The Lord blessed him for his faithful teaching of the gospel in the face of much opposition. Helaman chapter 10, verses 5 through 7, quote, "And now, because thou hast done this with such unwearyingness, behold, I will bless thee forever, and I will make thee mighty in word and in deed, in faith and in works, yea, even that all things shall be done unto thee according to thy word. For thou shalt not ask that which is contrary to my will. Behold, thou art Nephi, and I am God. Behold, I declare it unto thee in the presence of mine angels, that ye shall have power over this people, and shall smite the earth with famine, and with pestilence, and destruction, according to the wickedness of this people. Behold, I give unto you power, that whatsoever ye shall seal on earth shall be sealed in heaven, and whatsoever ye shall loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. And thus shall ye have power among this people." Unquote. The power the Lord gave to Nephi in verse 7 was the sealing power, the authority to make any agreement, bond, or obligation entered into on earth also valid in eternity. This power is also called the keys of the kingdom of heaven. Nephi is one of only four individuals in the scriptures who were explicitly given this power. Alongside him were the Apostle Peter, Joseph Smith, and Hiram Smith. The Old Testament prophet Elijah had the sealing power. With it, he sealed the heavens, resulting in a devastating two-year drought. As we're going to read in a moment, Nephi used the sealing power in a similar manner. Without even returning to his home, Nephi immediately went to preach throughout the land, warning of the coming destruction. Despite the miracle he had performed in identifying the chief judge's murderer, no one believed his preaching. The Nephites became even more hardened and tried to have Nephi imprisoned, but he was taken by the Spirit and conveyed away out of the midst of them. He traveled throughout Nephite lands, declaring the word of God to all. The Nephites became so angry and divided among themselves that civil war broke out among them. In the 14-year period described in chapter 11, the Nephite people again underwent the prosper bondage cycle we discussed earlier. Destruction and suffering. The Nephites had been engaged in a civil war for 2 years. Nephi called upon God to institute a famine to stir them up in remembrance of the Lord their God, and perhaps they will repent and turn unto him. The Nephites stopped fighting among themselves, but the famine killed thousands of Nephites and Lamanites in the more wicked parts of the land. Humility and repentance. After 2 years of famine, the people began to remember the Lord their God and the words of Nephi. They pleaded with the leaders of the government to ask Nephi to end the famine. Nephi prayed to the Lord, mentioning to him the repentance and humility of the people, and asked the Lord to turn away his anger and bless the people again. In the following year, the Lord caused the rain to return. Righteousness. The Nephite people did rejoice and glorify God, and did no more seek to destroy Nephi, but they did esteem him as a great prophet and a man of God. Blessing and prosperity. The Nephites began to prosper again in the land and began to build up their waste places and began to multiply and spread, even until they did cover the whole face of the land, both on the northward and on the southward, from the sea west to the sea east. The church again spread throughout the land, and most Nephites and Lamanites belonged to it. There was exceedingly great peace. Pride and wickedness led to destruction and suffering. In only 4 years, all these gains were reversed. In the 78th year of the Judges, the Nephites began to have a few contentions over points of doctrine, which led to much strife in the following year. Nephi, Lehi, and other men of God were able to put an end to the disputes, but the damage had already been done. In the 80th year, Nephite dissenters reconstituted the Gadianton band and did make great havoc, yea, even great destruction among the people of Nephi and also among the people of the Lamanites. The Nephite armies went into the wilderness to destroy the Gadiantons, but they were unable to succeed in the face of overwhelming numbers. The Gadiantons became so strong that they murdered, stole, and kidnapped at will throughout the land. The cycle repeated all over again. Now this great evil, which came unto the people because of their iniquity, did stir them up again in remembrance of the Lord their God. The people, however, began again to forget the Lord their God, and they began to wax strong in iniquity, and they did not mend their ways. Pride and wickedness increased, and thus they were ripening again for destruction. Helaman chapter 12 is an editorial insertion by Mormon in which he commented at length about the state of the Nephites at that time and how it was a pattern for the state of mankind in general. Mormon first summarized the prosper bondage cycle. Helaman chapter 12, verses 1 through 3, quote, "And thus we can behold how false, and also the unsteadiness of the hearts of the children of men. Yea, we can see that the Lord in his great infinite goodness doth bless and prosper those who put their trust in him. Yea, and we may see at the very time when he doth prosper his people, yea, in the increase of their fields, their flocks, and their herds, and in gold, and in silver, and in all manner of precious things of every kind and art, sparing their lives, and delivering them out of the hands of their enemies, softening the hearts of their enemies, that they should not declare wars against them, yea, and in fine, doing all things for the welfare and happiness of his people, yea, then is the time that they do harden their hearts, and do forget the Lord their God, and do trample under their feet the Holy One. Yea, and this because of their ease, and their exceedingly great prosperity. And thus we see that except the Lord doth chasten his people with many afflictions, yea, except he doth visit them with death, and with terror, and with famine, and with all manner of pestilence, they will not remember him." Human hearts are false and unsteady. The Lord will only bless and prosper us if we put our trust in him. After the Lord pours out abundant blessings upon his people, their usual reaction is to harden their hearts and forget the Lord their God and trample under their feet the Holy One because of their ease and prosperity. My belief is that this is happening in America and across the world today. We have been so materially prosperous for so long that God has become an afterthought for a large segment of our society. Mormon then explained that the problem is the natural man, as it is called in the scriptures. Helaman chapter 12, verses 4 through 6, quote, "Oh, how foolish, and how vain, and how evil, and devilish, and how quick to do iniquity, and how slow to do good are the children of men. Yea, how quick to hearken unto the words of the evil one, and to set their hearts upon the vain things of the world. Yea, how quick to be lifted up in pride. Yea, how quick to boast, and do all manner of that which is iniquity. And how slow are they to remember the Lord their God, and to give ear unto his counsels. Yea, how slow to walk in wisdom's paths. Behold, they do not desire that the Lord their God, who hath created them, should rule and reign over them, notwithstanding his great goodness and his mercy towards them, and they do set at naught his counsels, and they will not that he should be their guide." Unquote. Mormon exclaimed, "How great is the nothingness of the children of men! Yea, even they are less than the dust of the earth." Surely Mormon knew that the worth of souls is great in the sight of God. How then could he write such a thing? Because, Mormon explained, unlike human beings, everything else on the face of the earth, the dust, the hills, the mountains, the earth itself, bodies of water, and even people's riches, all obeys the Lord's voice. The Lord is all-powerful, and his decrees against those who work iniquity will come to pass. Because of this, repentance has been declared, and those who repent shall be saved. Mormon concluded with a fervent prayer that men might be brought unto repentance and good works, that they might be restored unto grace for grace according to their works. Mormon wanted all people to be saved, but he had read and knew that some will be cast off from the presence of the Lord, while others will have everlasting life. That concludes this lesson. If you enjoyed it, please click the thumbs up button and give it a like, and leave a comment below. Please subscribe if you'd like to be notified when new lessons are posted to this channel, and visit www.huarc.org to download the notes and slideshow for this lesson. Next week, we'll review the prophecy of Samuel the Lamanite, the sign of the birth of Christ, and the collapse of Nephite society as the time of Christ's death approached. The reading is Helaman chapter 13 through 3 Nephi chapter 7. See you then.